ways you can think of technology. You can be a techno-utopian and you can believe that technology will solve all our problems. Or you can be a techno-cynic and you can believe that technology will only make this world worse. The trouble with techno-utopians or techno-determinists is they think that technology is the solution. So if there is corruption version one, then we come up with corruption-busting technology version two or version one. But what we don't take into account is corruption also innovates as rapidly as technology. And before we know it, we have corruption version two, then we have to have corruption busting technology version two and so on. So it's an ongoing war. People at the UID believe that biometrics is one way to deal with corruption in India. The next presentation by Bernadette will demonstrate that biometrics is indeed fallible technology. If you look at the NIA bill, the bill that is supposed to regulate the UID project, they're trying to fool the technology is an offense under that bill. So if it was impossible to fool the technology, then you wouldn't have to make it a criminal offense. The very fact that the UIDAI has criminalized circumventing the technology means that the technology can be circumvented. So this is a quick presentation, hopefully, by Bernadette. She's standing between you and your dinner, so please forgive her as she goes quickly through this.
Going to be really quick because it's really easy. So I already told you, you have to get the fingerprint on a glass, for example. Then you have to make it visible. You can just use some powder from sharpen a pencil. That's quite easy. That's the same stuff the guys in the movies use. Then you photograph the print. And I already said maybe it's possible to directly photograph it. Then you have to refurbish it. Just make the lines nice. Any photo editor will do, any paint program, whatever. Then, that's the point, you have to print it on transparency film with a laser printer. That's really important because the laser printer, the black stuff the laser printer does, it's he puts stuff on there. So it's a little bit higher than the place where there's nothing. So you have the white ones, there's nothing, and the black ones, there's something. So if you add some favicol on that, you will have afterwards, so you have to wait, and then you will have the print on the favicol because of the black stuff the laser printer does it. And that's already it. So, and I prepared some here. I already have some finished ones, and if somebody wants to give it a try, you are welcomed, but the food is also waiting, so yeah, that's it.
Any questions for Bernadette? Okay, we'll take two quick questions and then hopefully close.
So, is there a program to generate fake fingerprints? Is there any program to generate fake signatures like that?
I don't know, but there sure is some two fake fingerprints. I even heard a guy, he took the prints from his foot and put it on his finger when he had to give the fingerprints, so.
Hi, I have one question. On the broad level, I can agree, I'm here. On the broad level, I can agree that yes, fingerprints can be saved, but you know, being an engineer and being a technologist and having worked on biometrics a lot, there are multiple layers of security we can establish. For example, not only check the person's fingerprint, but also check the blood flow that is going. Somebody can actually cut my finger and access it. So there are multiple layers of security.
Sure thing. I mean, you can also check the finger before you take the fingerprint.
Yes,
then
absolutely.
Then you can see if there's a fake fingerprint on it. So.
Like, I just want to know, what was the objective of this specific talk?
It's just to show that a fingerprint is not a key. It's not a key that is secure and secret, as I have shown before, the secret key, as it is just a public key. Everyone can take a photograph or grab your fingerprint and make a copy of it. That's everything. Actually.
All right. So going to the next level is basically iris-based biometric identification where people can scan persons' IDs. And further, I agree that even that can be spoofed. But then again,
sure.
You know, we have anti-spoof algorithms as well, which are highly patented and which are very accurate. So on the onset, I think it's a very accurate technology for establishing a person's identity. And I think that's very helpful.
Can I respond to that?
So oh, you've jumped it.
So given that I've actually looked at how this happens in the field, I'll tell you that the data in the database is garbage. And the reason it's garbage is the person collecting it has no incentive to collect data properly. Okay? So if you look at the conditions under which this data is collected, now you look at UID in particular, you know, the UID does not have an unlimited budget at data collection, nor do they have the staff. They outsource the operations. Who do they outsource it to? The lowest bidder, obviously. Okay? Now, what happens when the data is collected is you're going to have a mobile team that lands up in a village and says, let's enroll everybody today. Okay? These guys are working in conditions with limited power supply, and they need to maximize how much data they collect in a day because staying overnight is expensive. Okay, that's the cost, which means they're going to start working at 6 a.m. and go on working until sunset. Part of what happens once it gets dark is there's no power, there's no lights. They're sitting with LED lights, which basically then means that the quality of the image that's being captured is wrong. It's not good enough in the first place. Okay, and then they start cutting corners, you know, and just say, yeah, just put your finger down, get your data and get out. So this basically results in data that is not basically good enough. Okay, and this is something that the UID has no control over because the data is garbage before it gets to them. Okay, and this is the reality of what's happening out there. So it doesn't matter how good the technology is because the technology is not being used in the first place.
Hopefully it's the last question.
So on this one only, you're saying while you can fake this way, but the biometric is collected in, let's say, a smart card, a chip, which is encrypted. Yeah, let's right. So even if you can fake this, how it will get into the chip is the question. So there are additional level of access one needs to the database.
No. So
which you assume that it will be there.
How does it get into the database in the first place? At some collection center.
Yeah.
I can fake it when I give it to them.
When you store it in the database, you're
yes,
saying.
Because if you notice what the UID itself has learned about this, some people don't have fingerprints, especially tobacco workers, because working with tobacco essentially burns your skin to the point where your fingerprints are gone and now you can't collect the fingerprint, which is really why iris scanning was introduced. Because then iris scanning has trouble with blind people. So there are problems that come up in all kinds of places, and the quality control at the time of collection is very poor. Okay. Nobody is doing collection a second time with a different team to cross-verify that the first team got it right.
So do you have red flag rules equivalent here today in India?
I'm not aware of that.
No.
We'll try and close. I think if we put together the whole discussion, perhaps biometrics are okay as an identification factor, but they're not really a useful thing as far as authentication factor is concerned. So we ideally don't have to store biometrics in a central database. They can be stored onto a smart card. The smart card can use digital signature infrastructure. So I think if with so many smart software engineers and hardware engineers in the country, surely we can come up with a robust design for the project. We're not anti-technology. We're not anti-biometrics. We're not anti-identity management. But surely we need a secure system that all of us knows works well. I've heard of attacks where I go to one of those bankers that were exposed in the Cobra Post scandal, and I want to store all my hawala and black money. So I use my right hand and his left hand, and then that's a unique set of biometrics that goes into the dedupe engine. So the moment the registrar is corrupt, then the amount of attacks increase dramatically. So how to make sure there are no corrupt registrars? Very complicated question. During my time in engineering college, I did the data entry for the Epic card. It was subcontracted, finally to an engineering student who was trying to get money for his beer. First day I did data entry accurately, made no mistakes. It went with no complaints. Second day I introduced two mistakes on purpose to check if they were checking. From the third day I was typing rubbish. So if some of you have nonsense on your election cards, it's thanks to people like me who were just looking to get some money for our beer. So thanks for staying with us. It's been a long evening. Dinner is served. Once again, please thank all of my colleagues, starting with Bernadette, Laird, Purba, and Maria for the excellent presentations. Please remember we have an exhibition also going. I know the work we do is really boring. People's eyes glaze over every time I start talking about policy research. But do pick up your plate and walk through the exhibition. Hopefully you will find something that fascinates you. Thank you so much for coming.